one of my top points is that I'm fast in one hold up, and yeah, in Moto3, Moto2, and also now in MotoGP, I am able to find the limit and to manage this limit for one full lap without crashing. That is also important. But this is strange because when you are there making this lap, you are not thinking about to finish, just to finish the next corner. I just think like, yeah, next corner, and when I finish, the next one.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, it's corner by corner, right. Not even lap by lap. And yeah, a lot of adrenaline. I can push myself, and also physically, I think I can push myself to a point that when I finish the lap, I'm destroyed. Mm. And maybe not all the riders can do this. But yeah, also you need to work a lot during the weekend to try to find this limit, and you can put everything together in Saturday.
Hello, welcome to Last on the Brakes. If you're wondering why, hello Dennis Onju, goodbye. If you're wondering why we're stood between two trucks and two handheld mics, we've not decided to drastically change the layout of this podcast. No, I'll tell you what happened.
This is not the news at 10.
No, it's not the news at 10, despite my sheets as well. Let's tell you what happened right now. Well, last week we recorded a podcast with Jorge Martin, one of the most recent winners in MotoGP. Right at the end of that interview, there was a particular press conference where a certain 9-time world champion decided he was to retire. And this week, there's no space left in the media centre for us to record the intro and outro.
So welcome to Pramac.
Yes, we're at the track. So yeah, for all of you just listening to that, I probably sound a little bit weird, but there's a little backstory, a bit behind the scenes. This is the Last on the Brakes podcast with myself, Matt Dunn, and Fran Wild next to me. Fran, how are you?
I'm good, thank you.
Excellent. Are you excited to listen back to the podcast with Jorge Martin at any point soon?
I am indeed, yes. And I'm also excited that we're in the shade.
Yeah, that is the main aspect of this.
It's absolutely burning.
Yes, but it's absolutely brilliant. We've actually just recorded next week's podcast with Eric Granado. So spoiler alert, that's the next episode. But this one, we're not going to do any questions of the week. We just want to admire the podcast blessing that has happened once again. It's reignited. Jorge Martin came on this podcast on the Thursday before the Styrian Grand Prix. And what did he do Sunday? Ha, he won it. And then, not only that, what was the main topic of the conversation we talked about, Fran?
Yeah, it was all just about winning, being fast.
Converting that fast pace into winning.
Into actually winning, yeah. So it's great. He did do it. He very much did do it. And straight back from that injury as well and all those struggles, like in Assen. Imagine on race day in Assen, you'd said the person who's going to win the next race is that guy.
I know. Magic, isn't it?
Incredible stuff from him.
Yes. You might be able to hear actually what we're talking about because he's only above us at some point. Or it depends if he's arrived yet from his home.
To be fair, we're not roasting him, so no, I think it'd be okay.
Fantastic. No, I mean, and it was such a great chat with Jorge. He's really sort of inside. We talked a lot about resilience as well because he's come back from a lot of injuries and especially back to the very top of MotoGP.
Literally. And for the first time on top of MotoGP. Incredible stuff. Really great race, obviously. I'm sure you've all watched that by now. Great performance. Juan Mir tried his best, but even reigning champion couldn't quite keep up with him, even at a track that's been so emblematic for Juan Mir as well. Excited to see what he can do again this weekend, but certainly incredible stuff. We saw flashes of it in Qatar already with that podium, and he did lead the majority of that race as well, but this time got the job done right to the very end as well. So basically just how great was that? We are going to take some responsibility with the podcast blessing, and good on you, Jorge. It was really great to see that.
Yeah, we basically were the psychologist talking through how he's going to convert that raw pace into an actual MotoGP race win, and he did it. So basically, rider coaches 2022 for Pramac Racing. See you there.
Hopefully the sarcasm in that is very clear and do not expect too much of us in that way. But yeah, thanks very much for joining us. Hope you enjoy our chat with Jorge Martin. I think it's a really good one, interesting one, and super relevant. Now he's taken that maiden MotoGP win. So take it away, Jorge. As previously discussed, the first question is very serious. Jorge, welcome. How was your summer break? How are you feeling? Obviously some injury struggles. You ready to go now, second half?
Yeah, it's been really, really nice summer break for me. I think I think it was one of the best moments of the year because after the injury, I needed this time and I could make a bit of everything, time for relax with the friends, time to enjoy also the beach, but also to train and get ready for the second half of the season.
I was just going to say, it's a bit longer this year as well, right? Extra time helped you out a bit?
Maybe a bit too much, because in the last weeks I was really looking forward to come back and to start racing, but yeah, I think it was good enough and time enough also for me to recover, and I'm feeling almost 100%. I think I'm still missing some strength, but much better than in the last race, so really happy.
What was the most important part of that rest period for you? Was it the actual rest itself or needing to build back strength again?
Well, I think both, no? Because I had like a small muscle injury also after Assen, so I needed that time for rest and to get well again. And afterwards, I started preparing a lot the training and also the strength, and I feel much better, a lot stronger than in the last race. So I think both sides were really important for me.
So we want to talk about a few different things this podcast. The point is not to be like, so Jorge, how are you feeling about the weekend? So Jorge, tell us about this moment. Bit more of an informal chat.
Okay.
So with you at the start of your career, going back a little bit, Moto3, that kind of era, obviously you've been incredibly fast most of the time you've been in the paddock. But there's also that kind of strength, mental toughness we've seen you need when with a few injuries last year with COVID as well. But in Moto3, you were so quick, but it took you a while to then get onto the top step, and it seems like learn how to turn that speed into a win. Is that something you do have to learn, or starting off your career here, is the speed more important, or what? How has that journey started?
It's difficult,
for you?
Difficult to say, because you know, if I knew how to win, for sure, I would do it in the first race. No, but I think the experience gives you these wins. No, because if you are a fast rider, at the end of the day, someday you will be winning. And yeah, I remember in Moto3, I was making already a lot of pole positions, but I was missing this victory a lot. I think maybe when you want something too much, maybe you stress a bit and you don't think clear. And I think in that moment, also another riders like Mir was really, really strong in the battle and fighting. And yeah, that's why also I was missing the victory, also some injuries. It was a really tough year for me, but finally in Valencia, I was full focus, and I was working a lot to make maybe another strategy, try to be away, no, and to have a good gap to win, and yeah, at the end you have to find your own strategy and your own way to win, and finally I did it. So
how hard was that to go? Because that was a full season, it wasn't a COVID season, it was, you know, to get it right at the end, but you started the season with that pole position.
Well, yeah.
At what point, was there a point where you were like,
ah? I think, I started really good with the first race in Qatar, pole position already, but then I was making podiums almost every race, and I was happy with this. Mm. I was making points, I was battling for a championship because I was really close. And then when we arrived to Germany, I remember that I was first, all the first practice, and then in the second practice, I had this big injury, and I think this was the best moment of the year, because I was coming in a really good shape to Sachsenring, and I think was maybe the moment to win. Then we lost a lot of time. Anyway, I was always battling, that was the important thing. And yeah, that's why also I decided to stay in Moto3 another year, because I had a lot of chances to go to Moto2, but maybe sometimes it's better to stop a bit, try to think the best option. And obviously was to remain, because the year after I won the championship.
You did. You seem to really have learned how to win.
Yeah.
Forever then.
You see it in the next year.
Yeah. Obviously that was an incredible year for you. It was also a great year for the fans watching that battle between you guys. Obviously Marco Bezzecchi for most of the time, and then Fabio right at the end as well really came on strong. But once you have got that win, then how do you then keep it going? Is it pressure gone? Is it, what's the difference once you've taken that victory to then go on and fight for the championship like you did and then take it as well?
Yeah, for sure, when you arrive in the World Championship, you need to believe in yourself, and it's not easy, no? Firstly, you want to make a point. Then you want to make a top 10, then a podium, and everything is coming easier, no? For sure, I think the first barrier is the podium. Sometimes a rider stay a lot of years trying to fight for that podium, and then when it came, then they make a lot of podiums in a row. I think mentally it's really important to believe in yourself, and that's the way to do it. And when I won, I remember all the summer, all the winter break, I was training, and I knew I could win, so I was really motivated to start the the 2018 season.
Was there a part of you which wished there was another race on the end of that to get another
So let's add on another five now, guys. I've got it.
Yeah. It's my moment.
Why is it though that there are some riders, I don't want to name names and pick on anybody, but there are some riders who get that one win and then they don't get another one. Why is that?
I don't know. Maybe they are lucky, no? In some point of their career. Maybe they are not talented enough, or I don't know. Or maybe they don't work in the best way that you can. For sure, if you have the talent and you work correctly, for sure results come.
Yeah.
And you know, I think I am an example of that.
But for, yeah, so for you, it was like, oh, I've got the win. I can do it again.
If you can do one thing, I mean, if you can do it one time, you can do it more times for sure.
Awesome. Okay, so Moto2 then. Obviously, you said then that you had the chance to move up before you did, but you chose to stay. Then Moto2, you had a bit of a more difficult time at times. And then last year, of course, COVID got in the way as well. And when you lose the chance to fight for that championship, were you tempted again to be like, no, I'm going to stay and take it? Or did you feel the time was right? And what's the difference between then and when you made that decision in Moto3?
When I, last year in Moto2 for sure was good, but the year before also, it was really difficult with the KTM. We were struggling a lot. Also Brad, he was struggling. We were struggling even to make points. So it was really difficult. But then when the project stops, I remember we kept the same frame for all the season, and then we started to work in a better way and making results. At the end of the year, I did two podiums. I was constantly in the top five. So at the end of the year, it was really good. But yeah, my target was to stay 2 years in Moto2, because I think sometimes some riders also, you can see that if you stay more than 2 years, then it's more difficult to go up in MotoGP. At the end of the day, MotoGP is the target for all the riders. And I signed the contract quite early, because I wanted to jump. But I was also convinced that I was going to be fast in Moto2, and last year, I mean, I won races, I did a lot of podiums.
We won't talk about the one here.
For me, it was a victory. That's the important thing. I was unlucky because I had the COVID, the first rider also.
I remember getting the phone call about that. I was like,
It was really unlucky. Also, I mean, losing two races because of COVID. Then the two races I was back, I did zero. And even though I recovered points to the first rider. So, I mean, I was it was my moment also to win the championship last year. And yeah, maybe this is the thing it hurts the most. But yeah, at the end I am in Ducati, in MotoGP with a factory bike and
can't complain too much, can you?
I mean, I can't complain a lot. It's okay for me.
I do want to ask you though about like motivation and whether you have had to change the form of motivation at different times in your career because of an injury or because you stepped on a Moto2 bike and the KTM wasn't quite as good as you had hoped it would be. And then you changed your motivation again last year because you can no longer win the championship because of having COVID. Did it change for you, or is it always just the same motivation? I'll just get win races and see what happens.
Yeah, for sure it's different. I mean, when I won the Moto3 World Championship and I jumped into Moto2, my expectations were really high because you come from winning almost every race, and then you go to Moto2 and you are 15. So this was really difficult for me mentally. I remember I was crying a lot. Also sometimes after maybe FP3 that I was out of Q2, or some moments that I was doubting about myself. Even if I was world champion, I was doubting, no? And these moments were really tough. But yeah, at the end, the only person that knows me, no, is me, and I was able to regain, no, this motivation and try to fight back, and yeah, at the end of the day, I was motivated enough to be back on the podium. But it's not easy, also not in MotoGP. I mean, last injury was tough. It was a moment I said, no, in the interview with Dorna, that I was thinking even to quit, because there are some really tough moments, but afterwards I think I want to win, I want results, and that's why I keep pushing myself.
So what made you not quit then? How do you come back from that point? Is that almost, is that the secret to being here and being successful? If you can take those moments and then climb your way back up again?
for sure for me, it's better not to have these moments, because if you if you just think about it 1 second, it's not good, because for sure some part of you wants to quit if you think about it. But for sure, when you are in your lowest, you don't think about winning. You don't think about when you celebrate. You just think that you have pain, that you don't want to be in that pain. But yeah, for sure, when you improve, then you feel better again, and you want to come back and train again to be on the bike. But in that moment, it was really difficult.
Because looking through some of the statistics and some of the crashes that you had, have you sort of built up lessons from each either injury or race loss? Like not just talking about injuries here, to then when you come in a situation like you had this year, that it feels not normal, but like, okay, I know what to do again. Is that how it is?
Yeah, I mean, I am one rider that used to recover really fast and I come back really, really fast after an injury. But for sure, it's not the same in Moto3 than in MotoGP, no? Mm-hmm. Because you have bigger bike, better riders. I mean, here we are the top level of the world, and for sure, last injury, I was thinking, yeah, I can come back. I did podium in Qatar. Now I can be back again in a good level. But yeah, I mean, in Moto3 was much easier. I remember coming back here in Austria.
Goodness, yeah.
And I was on the podium 2 times.
Yeah.
So yeah. For sure, now in MotoGP, everything is more difficult, and also coming from an injury. But yeah, the important thing is to learn from mistakes. Try not to repeat the same mistakes as in the past. But you know, you always can make mistakes. New mistakes, not different mistakes. But I hope to be more calm from now on and try to understand the situations before pushing.
Mm-hmm. I guess as well, coming into MotoGP, obviously, like you said, it's what every rider's aiming for. You've made it here. You knew you had that contract quite early as well. Mentally, you had a little bit longer knowing where you're going, what you're going to be doing. But when you do start in the Premier Clash, you head out in those tests and you're like, okay, I'm literally on the grid with like Rossi and Mark and these people who've been winning for decades, if you include Valentino. How do you prepare for that feeling? Is it really different to kind of take on like, right, this is literally the top level now?
Yeah, it's nice also, but I didn't get ready for that. I just went to the test, went on the bike and
full gas. I love how casual that is.
And I tried my best, but yeah. For sure, the good thing is that when you jump into MotoGP, you are not thinking to win. You just think, I want to enjoy, I want to have fun, and for sure, being with these guys is amazing. Maybe the first test and the first race also that I was battling with Valentino was really nice and I really enjoyed, but from that point, they are just another rivals and you just want to
That's
beat
awesome.
Them.
Yeah. To just destroy them.
Yeah, I mean, not destroy them, but for sure to be in front. And yeah, I really enjoy to watch the pictures, no, the photos in the evening with great riders. I really enjoy. And also, I try to learn from them, no, because at the end, they are legends, and to be here is amazing.
Sounds like you already, in the first half of the season, really appreciate just the fact that you are a MotoGP rider, that you've made it to that level. Is that true?
I still don't believe it. It's crazy. I mean, I've been all my life fighting for this, and for sure I have bigger targets, no, in my life, like to be world champion in MotoGP, but yeah, still, when I come to the paddock and see all the trucks, all the bikes, all the team that I have around me, it's crazy. A lot of people working for me, and you feel more important, but it's still difficult to manage the situation.
It doesn't sound like you feel too much pressure from that, though.
No, I mean, I don't feel pressure for the moment. I feel pressure when I need to win or my team is asking me for win. It's also good for me, because when I have pressure, actually, I push myself in a better way, but I don't feel pressure. I just want to enjoy, try to learn, and try to be as fast as possible.
Well, you've already ticked a couple of goals off, I guess.
Yeah.
That incredible weekend in Qatar really started on a high this season. How did that feel? And if you say you don't even believe that you're here yet, even competing in MotoGP, do you believe that you've like been on the podium already and that incredible stint you had as well, leading that race? It was an amazing weekend.
Yeah, it was amazing. I think also because of Qatar, now I don't have this pressure, no? Because
I guess it helps
one target,
early,
one really important target this season was to make a podium. and I just did it on the second race. So afterwards, we're like, I did it already. Yeah. Now I can relax a bit. But yeah, I think when this kind of weekends appears, no, that you from FP1 you feel good, you feel in the top five, and everything is coming easy. You need to take profit of this, and yeah, I did a really great job in that race. I wasn't expecting to be on the podium, even if I was starting on pole. My target was to finish top seven, top eight, and try to learn.
I remember reading your quotes on the Saturday, and you were like, no.
I want to learn, tomorrow's a day to learn.
And then however many laps you spent in the lead, we were like, but he's still there, he's still there.
It was amazing. Yeah, for sure, when Fabio overtook me, I tried my best to be on the podium. But yeah, I think everybody was impressed. But a lot of people were thinking that was possible. My team was pushing a lot, and they were believing more in me than myself, no? So it was also great for me to know more about my team, about my new family, because we just worked together for 7 days in that moment.
Well, yeah, it's true as well. It's so early in the relationship you have with them, yeah.
Yeah, but we are a great team. I have an amazing family here, and I really enjoy to be here with them.
Last sort of topic before we do our little quick fire questions. You showed obviously in that first couple of weekends, you are so naturally fast. But I always have a question when you get to MotoGP and you are fast out the blocks. If it is actual just talent making you that fast, or if it's actually the hard work and principles that you took from Moto 3 to Moto 2 that make you fast there.
Do you expect him to be like, no, I'm not talented
No. I mean, like, obviously talent's part of it, but like, how much of that is talent and hard work? Makes it.
I think, I mean, the guy that is fast for a whole lap will be always fast for the whole lap. Yeah. I mean, this is one strong point that I have. For sure, you can take another rider and he will have another good point, but one of my top points is that I'm fast in one whole lap, and yeah, in Moto3, Moto2, and also now in MotoGP, I am able to find the limit and to manage this limit for one full lap without crashing. That is also important. But this is strange because when you are there making this lap, you are not thinking about to finish, just to finish the next corner. I just think like, yeah, next corner. And when I finish, the next one.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, well, it's corner by corner, right. Not even lap by lap. And yeah, a lot of adrenaline. I can push myself, and also physically, I think I can push myself to a point that when I finish the lap, I'm destroyed. Mm. And maybe not all the riders can do this. But yeah, also you need to work a lot during the weekend to try to find this limit, and you can put everything together in Saturday.
That's really cool. Corner by corner, that sounds exhausting.
It's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah. I don't know how you have the discipline to not just let it run away in your mind. I know obviously that's the difference between you and me.
Yeah, maybe.
But things like this, how you manage to do that corner by corner, lap after lap after lap, is pretty incredible.
Yeah, yeah.
But I want to ask as well, just one final thing. Sure. A lot of people say, it's like a bit of a paddock phrase, that you can't teach people to be fast, but you can teach them to stop crashing, for example. If there's that talent there, you can kind of work on the other stuff. What do you think that's true at all? Because there's a lot of different ways to becoming a top level MotoGP rider. You see so many different journeys. What do you think it is, just truly that whole package, putting it together?
I think it's really difficult to understand the best way to be fast or to be in a top level, because it's not like football or basketball that everybody knows about it and they know like the way to do it. Here you can see that all the riders train a different way. Mm-hmm. Everybody is making different things, and at the end of the day we are all fast, no? So yeah, I try to make a bit of everything. And yeah, also I think about what you were speaking, I think it's better also to have a rider that is always pushing and crashing and need to stop him a bit, than to have a rider that you need to motivate, no? And I am one of the first riders. I always try to push, and maybe I crash too much. But if you control this rider, you can have a lot of potential. And yeah, I think we are working on it.
Awesome.
Well, like we said, it started very well, and now with that reset after summer, let's see.
Good luck.
Sure. Right then.
Quick fire questions. You. Couple minutes left. We always start off with this one, and then we have some from the fans as well. First one is, and you can have a think about this. Which three people, dead or alive, would you like to have at a dinner party together?
Ooh, a dinner party.
They can be anybody. Celebrities, to some people have chosen their friends. That's a bit boring, but...
Yeah, please don't do that.
But if you want to come back to it, you can.
Okay, so Well, it's difficult to say. For sure, let me think a little bit.
Do you want, we'll come back to that at the end, yeah? Should we leave
Yeah,
you?
let me think.
Okay, cool.
I've got an idea of one. I think I know one you might say. You said about it in another interview previously. Yeah. You want to do the next one?
Oh, the pressure. So we had one from Craig about the three tracks before, but like which three tracks are the best on calendar. However, Matt Polanski has now asked, which track not on the calendar would you like MotoGP to go to? So there's a few we've been to before, there's a few we've never raced.
Yeah, I would like to go to Jarama. You know Jarama in Madrid?
Yeah.
Classic hometown.
Yeah,
there.
It's just 5 minutes from my hometown and you know, it's always nice to be there and it's a really nice layout with uphills and downhills, a bit, not like Portimao, but
it's
really enjoyable, like but for MotoGP it's really dangerous because you don't have, like when you crash, you hit the wall, so for sure it's really difficult.
Not ideal. Awesome. That's a good answer. I didn't expect that.
The Madrid. Yeah. Love it.
Hey, Mike Falcone says, who helped you get where you are that we haven't heard about before?
I mean, there's a lot of people that you haven't heard before, but maybe, yeah. I mean, at the end, my father, my family, that you know about him, is the one that helped me the most. But nice. Yeah, my family in general, my uncles, my grands also, and maybe all my trainers, all my physios, my nutritionists, all these people that is helping me that you don't know. I think maybe because of them.
Cool.
Okay, so Chicky McFly has asked, which day in your life would you like to relive?
I would like to relive the 4th of November of 2018 when I won the championship in Moto3 because
I love that you literally know the date.
Yeah, I have it here also.
Ah, okay, cool.
2018.
I was looking at a few of these. I'm awesome. A big fan.
Yeah, because cool. I think I didn't enjoy that much that day because when you are there inside, you don't believe it for sure, but you don't know how to enjoy it because it's the first time. And hope so I can repeat a world championship to be more prepared.
to be more prepared to celebrate exactly. Well. Exactly. I love it.
Team Japan GP, what is your personal or professional motto? So like a phrase that you say to yourself occasionally. Or do you not have one? What would it be?
Yeah, I have one that normally I say with my father. It's like, in Spanish we say, por lo negro sin salirse. It's like the asphalt that is black. Yeah. It's like going in the black and don't go outside, no? Like always pushing in the black. It's in Spanish, it's a bit better.
Yeah.
It's a phrase that I say a lot.
Right, your dinner party.
Yeah.
So, dinner party. It's difficult. I mean, it's tough because there's a lot of people. I think the first one will be Kevin Hart, for sure, because he's amazing. I love his films and I will laugh a lot, for sure.
I love that. I didn't expect that.
Maybe. I would say, thinking a bit, maybe Rafa Nadal, because I
knew it.
Because he's a really great sportman, and I would learn a lot from him, a lot. And I don't know, maybe some singer, no, or some. It's difficult, really difficult.
I think Kevin Hart.
Maybe some reggaeton singer.
Oh, no, don't say
that. Yeah, I love it.
Maybe
Nicky Jam.
Kevin Hart is going to have quite a Spanishy experience there, isn't he?
Trust me, we will enjoy a lot.
That would be very funny.
But yeah, maybe Nicky Jam. I like his songs, and I think he's a really natural guy. So
cool.
It will be nice.
Hey. Thank you very much
for
your time.
Thanks for your time.
Yes, thank you so much. And yeah, best of luck with the rest
of
the season.
Let's try my best.
Congrats for Qatar, like we said, and hopefully more
full gas
from here on out. So, hope you enjoyed that chat with Jorge Martin. We certainly enjoyed sitting down with him. It's been one on the list for a while. Pretty interesting journey to where he is now, and especially even more so now he is a MotoGP race winner. So yeah, as we already did reveal in the intro, who's the next guest?
Yes, Eric Granado. I was just wondering, Fran, does that make the interview that we just done outdated now? He's actually won.
I guess in some ways, we need to probably
also,
try and get him back on again.
By the time this is published, we'll know who won the Austrian Grand Prix as well.
We will indeed.
But anyway, hope you enjoyed it. Eric Granado, who might have won the coming Moto E race, is on the podcast next week.
Let's see if the blessing continues.
I know.
But thank you very much for joining us. It's always a pleasure. And come back for more. Let us know any questions, comments, feelings, anything. Nice and kind with it, please, as ever.
Hashtag MotoGP podcast.
In the comment section on YouTube, if that's where you're watching us and suffering our faces. Thanks very much, and ciao for now.